If you've been conducting this experiment along with the students in our video, you now have data. What do we mean by data? We mean any measurement or description of the results of your experiment. So you are now ready to move on to the next science practice, analyzing and interpreting data. And to really keep things moving, at the same time, we can utilize another science practice, using mathematics and computational thinking. So let's get back to the classroom to put these practices together.
Everyone should now have measurements from all 10 samples. So the first thing we'll want to do is make sure to organize the data in a data table. A simple data table might look like the letter T, like this. In this data table, you have data that your team collected and measured. If at all possible, we need to add measurements made by other teams. It's important to get several measurements at each water sample location. We call this replication. Can anyone tell me why you think replication is important?
Well, if all you have is one measurement taken at a single station and the machine you were using is broken, then it might not have been measuring correctly.
I agree. It's important to make sure that you have several measurements from each location so you can make sure your measurement device is working correctly. If several teams all measure in a similar way, we can safely assume that all the machines are working correctly. Is there any other reason that you might want to replicate your measurements?
I have an idea. It might be that the person doing the measurement is not being careful enough or isn't using the measuring tool correctly.
Sure, that's possible too. What you're identifying are called sources of error, and replicating your measurements is a good way to cut down on sources of error in the experiment. So let's look at a sample of data that could have been collected if we had four teams working on this experiment. This data table is very helpful because it shows a lot of numbers all at once. If we utilize the science practice of using mathematics and computational thinking, we can easily calculate a number called the average, or the mean value of pH at each station. You've probably done this in other classes. Tell me why we want to calculate an average value for the pH values at each station. Sam.
By calculating the average, we can show the results of our measurements at each station using just one number. That makes it easier to understand.
You're right. Calculating an average number makes it easier for us to see patterns in the data. Notice that every team did not find identical pH values at each station. There are slight differences. Can anyone explain how to calculate the average pH at each station?
I can. Yeah. For station one, for example, just add up the four pH numbers measured and divide by the number of measurements, which is four.
Yep, that'll work perfectly. Let's try it together. Station one showed these four pH values measured by different teams: 6.70, 6.75, 6.80, and 6.80. When we add them up, we get 27.05. Then we divide 27.05 by four, and the average pH at station one is 6.7625. We'll report it as 6.76. This pH value is listed to only two decimal places because of the significant figures. Significant figures represent the precision of a measurement. If we calculate the average pH value at all 10 stations and list them in a new data table, it'll look like this.
I realize that our teacher for this unit just introduced significant figures, a very important aspect of chemistry. Significant figures are extremely useful for getting a handle on very specific numbers. Now, some of you may have already studied significant figures, but if you haven't, or if you just want to get a better handle on them, you can check out the Closer Look section for Unit 1. Okay then, I now return you to our classroom lab already in progress.
Now let's think back and use the fourth science and engineering practice, analyzing and interpreting data. We'll use the chart to describe what this data tells us about what happened during the fish kill. One of your teams used phenolphthalein, an indicator that turns pink in the presence of a base. Let's hear about that data.
Well, I remember the fish kill happened near stations 3 and 4. If we compare the pH colors there to the pH colors at the other stations, you'll see a big difference.
Can you describe that difference?
The water upstream from the fish kill, stations 1 and 2, stayed clear. Then at the fish kill, it turned pink, the way you said it would, in the presence of a base. But then the pink got lighter further downstream at stations 5 and turned clear at station 6. Maybe that was because a nearby creek was adding more water to the river at that spot. The other station showed a light pink color indicating a base in the water from stations 7 to 10.
That's a great description of our qualitative data, and your reasoning about the stream helps explain your results too. Now what about the quantitative data?
Well, look at stations 1 and 2. Those pH levels are all around 6.8, but all of a sudden, at stations 3 and 4, the site of the fish kill, the pH jumps up 0.7 points higher. Then downstream, the numbers start going down a little at stations 5 through 10.
Great description. So do you think the qualitative and quantitative data give us similar information?
Yeah, they seem to add up nicely, even though the quantitative data gives us more detail about the pH.
Great. So let's double check and make sure we remember what those numbers mean. If a water sample is measured at a pH lower than 7 on the pH scale, what do we call that solution?
It's an acid.
Right. And if a water sample is measured at a pH higher than 7, what do we call that solution?
That would be a base or an alkali.
Right. Nice job. We're now ready to use science practice number 6, constructing explanations. This is where you use the data you've analyzed to either support or reject your hypothesis. Remember, rejecting your hypothesis doesn't mean you're wrong. Your hypothesis doesn't need to be right. The experiment will give us the answer to the question we're asking. Now we'll use the data to construct an explanation of what happened on the Ogeechee River. We'll want to use sound reasoning for our explanation. Each student team will create a display board that uses the evidence measured in this experiment to make a claim about the cause of the fish kill. Show your display board to the other students and try to explain what you think happened to the fish based on the evidence you gathered in the experiment. Today we'll use a file folder as your display board, and you'll write in the file folder using a common format. When you prepare a display board, it's important to find out the requirements for the final display so you can provide all the requested information. For this display, you'll use a format similar to this. The guiding question is the question you're trying to answer. The claim is what we think caused the fish kill based on our experiment. For the evidence, it would help to draw a graph displaying the data from the experiment. Remember to graph the average pH value from each location. You should label the vertical axis with your responding variable, pH value, and the horizontal axis with your manipulated variable, sampling location. The section called justification of the evidence is where you explain what you think the data graph tells us about the cause of the fish kill and why you think the fish died. This is where you must demonstrate sound reasoning. At the bottom of your display board, brainstorm a list of problems or concerns that this fish kill might cause and ways to avoid this in the future. For example, there might be economic concerns due to the loss of fish, or maybe you have health concerns for people or animals eating the fish. There might be political concerns or legal ramifications if we try to determine whether or not someone's at fault for the fish kill. Maybe we can try to find out how to prevent future fish kills. Be creative in your thinking.
The ideas our teacher just mentioned are ideas for further investigation later down the road. For now, stop here and complete your display. Once it's finished, you can move on to the next video on the playlist.